Hi guys, what's up? This is Mark from Ekahau, Marketing Amazing Ekahau team. And today I wanted to talk you through why and how to do capacity calculations using Ekahau. In today's video, we will talk about three things. We will start with what is the capacity. Then we will talk about why is it important, absolutely important, to design against your clearly specified capacity requirements. And then we will talk about how to really model these capacity requirements and how to visualize them using Ekahau to see if you pass or fail against your capacity requirements. Let's start with what the capacity really is. And a quick disclaimer here, it is not possible to model capacity 100% in accordance to what it is going to look like in the real world, because you have no power over how many users really you are going to have in your environment and what really these users are going to do on all of their devices. Designing Wi-Fi networks has two main components. First one is easy. That's why Matt has talked about it already. It's about the coverage. And the second one that we are covering here today is capacity. Now, what is the capacity in Wi-Fi design? Capacity is making sure, in short, that we have enough radios serving certain amount of clients doing certain things. Next on the list to discuss is why is it absolutely crucial to design against clearly defined capacity requirements? And the answer is simple. We really need to know what we're doing there, because in most cases, capacity requirements are vastly exaggerated, and that leads to too many access points installed in your facilities. In most cases, when I go to Central London and do a validation survey or troubleshooting survey there, I realize that we have way too many APs, and that leads to more channel contention, more channel interference, more collisions, more retransmissions, and conversely, slower Wi-Fi. On the other hand, it is also possible to underscope your capacity requirements, and when you do that, you might have not enough radios to serve your clients and ensure that they can do what they want to do. To avoid these issues, we have to ensure that our capacity requirements are scoped as spotlessly as possible. I know it's impossible to do it 100% properly, but let's try to be as close as possible. When we do that, then we have to hit the right balance of number of radios serving our clients without overscoping it to avoid channel contention. And this leads us to an extremely important conversation about how to capture the requirements from your clients, and most importantly, how to translate those requirements into a more practical approach so we don't overscope the requirements for capacity in our Wi-Fi networks. So let's take a look. We have 20 by 10 meters office, and this office has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 desks, 8 people on each desk, which translates to roughly 100 users. And then you start capturing requirements, asking your clients about number of devices, what they are going to do with these devices and when and how. And they come back to you saying, oh, Mr. Mark, we are going to have 4 devices per person. You think, great, amazing, 4 devices. That's quite a lot, you think. This gives us a staggering 400 devices. Then you ask, what applications are your devices going to be using on your network? On your Wi-Fi network. The client comes back to you saying, they will be using email, of course, voice, of course, video. Who is not using video today, especially when tons of people are working from home, different city, different country, different continent? It's a reality today. Users in the office will be printing, maybe not as much as several years ago, but they will still do it. They will audio stream. You will have tons of users with the headphones on trying to focus on the task at hand while minimizing distractions. And there will be video streaming, if it's instructional YouTube videos or Udemy courses, or if it's a Netflix during the lunch break, they will stream. And now you start calculating what bandwidth these applications are going to be using on Wi-Fi. And you conclude that email, half meg per second. Then voice, every 20 milliseconds, you will have a tiny packet there and back. Half a meg with modern codecs, makes sense. A video, 2 megs per second is something that we have to assume here. Printing, 1 meg, than the audio stream, Spotify, or something like that. 1 meg per second is probably what it's using. Video stream, if it's a YouTube video or if it's something that is not extremely super high resolution that you typically don't use in the office environment, let's say just 1080p, then 3 megs per second, it doesn't sound like the exaggeration. So now when we add up all these values, we conclude that every single device requires to have 8 megs per second bandwidth. 400 devices doing 8 megs per second, it's quite a lot. Now let's try to translate those requirements from a client onto a more practical approach. So out of these 100 users, how many of them are we going to see in the office? 60? 50? Around that, some of them will be grabbing a coffee, some of them will be sitting in the toilet, some of them will be working remotely. So we are down, let's say, to 60 users, down from 100. And out of these 4 devices that people own, how many of them they will be using consecutively? How many of them will be unlocked on their desk, used for something? Maybe 2, maybe 3, not 4 at the same time. That would be a massive exaggeration. So let's say 3 devices per person. And now we have 3 devices times 60 users. It's 180 devices. It sounds a little bit more practical. So now let's talk about the practical assumptions. We have to assume that some users will not be in the office, that out of all of the devices they own, some of them will not be connected to Wi-Fi. Even if they are connected, some of them, they will not be actively used on Wi-Fi, not all of them. And not all the applications will be used on all the devices at the same time. You might be sitting on a meeting and browsing at the same time, but you won't be streaming while sitting on that meeting. Or you can be printing and streaming, but when you're doing these two things, you probably won't be sitting on a meeting. So it's massively exaggerated to assume that you will need to have 8 megs per second for all of those devices. So let's say that out of these 3 devices per person, 1 device will be your main device doing what? Everything at the same time? You can't do everything at the same time. So if you are on a video conference, you are on a video conference. It's 2 megs per second. It won't get any higher than that. When you are streaming, you're not streaming all the time. So let's say that you have 60 devices doing 2 megs per second, and these are the most active devices that all of your users in the office have. And now the secondary device will be just used for streaming music or something lightweight, let's say 1 meg per second. And then the remaining devices will be sitting on background sync. Of course, BS stands for background sync. And now your requirements, they are way less exaggerated, and you will be able to cater against this updated, translated requirements using less access points. And that's exactly what we want to do. We want to stay realistic. We don't want to exaggerate. We want our networks to hit the sweet spot between the number of radios and the capacity that you have from those radios. If you have too many radios, too many APs, it's bad. If you don't have enough APs, it's also bad. Good coverage does not equal good capacity. Okay, so now we understand how to come up with a number of devices and how to assign a bandwidth value, the SLA value, to those devices so it's a little bit more realistic. Let's take a look at this quick example here. And we have a small school with some classrooms around, with some corridors around, and a small auditorium in the middle. Now, we have captured the requirements for this space and understand that around the school, everywhere outside of the auditorium, it's a network that is just being used by teachers. No students, no parents, just teachers, doing very basic stuff. Browsing, sharing, presentations, very infrequently streaming. So we know that they won't have too many devices there. And all those devices, they will be quite lightweight when it comes to what they do on Wi-Fi. So let's take a look at the requirements for that area. We have concluded that we'll have maximum of 50 laptops and 50 smartphones, where the laptop is the main device doing 1 meg per second, because they are very lightweight anyway. And smartphones will be just doing background sync, being in the pocket, used sometimes for something small. That sounds quite realistic. Now, let's move to the auditorium. We have a different area here called the auditorium HD, auditorium high density. And inside the auditorium, we expect to see up to 150 parents watching their kids performing on stage. And what they are going to be doing is probably using their smartphones to record stuff on stage and send the recording to their spouses or to social media. So it will be slightly heavier, the requirements here, than around entire school. Let's take a look at what we expect to happen in this high density area. So we can see that we expect not to see more than 100 smartphones doing anything heavier than 2 megs per second. Additionally, we might have some laptops doing background sync that teachers will be using or some parents will be using. So this sounds like quite a realistic, if not slightly exaggerated, requirement for this auditorium HD area. Okay, so when we look at the signal strength, it's very good. It's quite fantastic. We have it everywhere, maybe not in the corner of the wardrobe, which we don't care too much about. But coverage, as you know, is not everything. So let's take a look at the capacity health. And capacity health, with the requirements that we've specified for that school, is passing everywhere except of the auditorium. And you can see that auditorium is light red, which means that we are exceeding the airtime. What can we do to improve that situation? First, let me remove the areas from the view so it's a little bit clearer. We need to have more radios inside the auditorium. And the auditorium is not too big, it's like 30 by 30-ish meters. So we probably would be able to have more omnidirectional internal APs there, that's what I'm using here. And one will be on one side, another would be on the other side. Let's recalculate the channels very quickly so we really have more capacity. And now let's go back to capacity health. We can see that it's now passed against our criteria, but the only problem that we can have here is most of the clients will be coming through that door or that door here in the bottom part, and they will probably associate with the first best AP. Now they will move, the clients will move to the other side of the auditorium, maybe here, and they will probably stay connected to the first AP on their path, even though they have a better AP available for them. So how to fix that issue? We can use directional antennas, and they don't have to be crazily high gain antennas, like 6 or 7 dBs is probably more than enough for this application. We will point them down and suspend them on the conduit bracket so they will create a very nice cone of coverage pointing towards users that they are serving, which is great. By doing it, we will limit the coverage area from these APs, from these antennas, and therefore, when clients, they move from one side of the auditorium to the other side, they will be jumping between these two APs, and therefore, we will be spreading load between these two APs, and that's exactly what we want and need. So let me delete these two access points, and let me add an AP with the antenna of my choice. Let's say we will use like a Cisco 9120 with external antenna slots, and 2566 antenna, that is exactly that, 6-7 dBi gain antenna. Let's place one of these APs, let's say here, and let's move to signal strength for selected access points. And if I select that AP now and edit that AP, I've specified that this access point will be mounted against the ceiling, not against the wall. Is mounted against the ceiling at 2.4 meters height, so suspended down from a ceiling, assuming that the ceiling is higher than 2.4 meters. And this is what this AP will cover. I can rotate it any way I want. Probably I want to move it slightly higher up, so it covers a little bit more, maybe 3 meters above the ground. And I am getting to the point where I am quite happy with the coverage from that AP. So maybe I will place it somewhere here, and now I will copy that access point, paste it, and I will move it here. So now I have two APs. When I select both of them, they're covering the atrium very nicely. Actually, I don't need to have coverage on stage or too much coverage, so I can move it back a little bit. And now when I take a look at signal strength from all the access points installed around, I have very directed coverage from each of those APs, and therefore when I have clients entering that door or that door, they will associate with that AP. Then when they start moving to the other part of the auditorium, they will start losing the coverage from this AP and antenna, and they will discover that one, connect to this one. So when I recalculate my channels and take a look at the capacity health for all my access points, it should be met. Everyone is happy, and we have ensured we have enough capacity using two radios in the auditorium higher density area. I hope it helps, and I will see you guys next time.